Hey everyone, this is a 10 gigabit networking switch. Well, actually, it's an empty box, but after setting up the actual switch over there, I was able to save a massive 20 seconds each week when video editing. Wait, what? Okay, so as it turns out, upgrading to 10 gigabit networking is hard and expensive if you do it right. And in some cases, it might be worth sticking to just 1 or 2.5 gig networking. So here's some of the difficulties I came across when trying to upgrade, and I'll also discuss whether I think it was actually worth paying the money and upgrading in the end. So firstly, when I knew that I simply had to upgrade to 10 gigabit networking because I developed FOMO from reading the HomeLab subreddit, I went looking at 10 gigabit PCI Express cards, and I found that they were really expensive. So I went on eBay and I purchased two used X540 T2 networking cards for £30 each. While these were a good enough deal, there's probably a few reasons why the original owners actually sold them. So firstly, they are fairly old cards running PCI Express Gen 2, which might not sound too bad, because if they work, they work, right? But since Gen 2 has lower bandwidth across the board, you need an X4 slot for them. Otherwise, you'll only get 1 gigabyte or less second speeds, which will be capping the networking potential for this card down quite a bit. And since barely any motherboards actually have X4 slots, you'll often need to use an entire X16 slot for your working card, which seems like a bit of a waste. A more recent PCI Express Gen 4 card, for example, could actually run in an X1 slot and still get the full bandwidth required for 10 gigabit networking. Secondly, these cards have a reputation for running really hot. It's well known that 10 gigabit RJ45 Ethernet is hot and energy inefficient, but these older X540 cards in particular seem to have an issue with getting really hot and then dying. It's great to find that out after buying them, of course. One good thing though is that these cards come with two RJ45 Ethernet ports, meaning that I could actually hook Ethernet ports up to both of them to a network switch that supports link aggregation, and then get double the networking speed, which is pretty neat. For example, I could get 2 gigabit speeds from a 1 gigabit switch, or 5 gigabit speeds from a 2.5 gig switch, which is pretty cool. But in general, these cards aren't really the best way of achieving 10 gigabit networking, as I've since discovered since buying them, especially due to a really annoying issue they actually have out the box. When I first built my HomeLab NAS, I noticed that it was noisy. It was noisy enough that I started keeping my study door shut in the night so they wouldn't keep everyone up. And through careful scientific research, which basically meant sticking my ear inside the case when the PC was running, I concluded definitively that the problem was with the CPU cooler. Blinking AMD stock coolers, they suck. So I started looking for alternative CPU coolers. But thankfully, I decided to do one last sound test before actually hitting the checkout button, and I realized that it's actually the networking card that's really noisy. I initially ruled this out because I didn't think that such a tiny device could actually be the cause of such large noise nuisance, but yes, yes, it was. The fan itself was constantly running at 100% all the time, and I couldn't really see a way of controlling this easily enough, especially on Debian, so I just unplugged the fan, and then that fixed the noise issue. Woohoo! Some other X540 cards have metal heatsinks, so I'll probably look to actually switch to these passively cooled ones in the future. For now though, I'm just going to ensure that I actually have an intake fan bringing cold air in past the card, which some people have done and had quite good success with, so I'm just going to stick to that on my HomeLab NAS instead. That brings me onto my next issue when moving your networking above gigabit speed, how you should actually achieve this. I just personally blindly stayed with Ethernet, also called 10G base T, because this is what I knew, and I already had dozens of Ethernet cables in my bag of networking crap, as my wife affectionately calls it. But it turns out that everything about 10G base T is hot and power hungry. It's usually actually better to go with SFP plus switches and transceivers, since these are better equipped for very high networking speeds. However, this is yet another technology to actually learn about and support in a household, which is often full of loads of tech anyway, and that's not always practical, especially because while SFP plus switches are cheaper, the actual transceivers add a big unexpected cost if you're not careful. This is where the cable choice matters a whole lot too. While copper Ethernet base T does actually work, you'll then need a separate transceiver module to use SFP switches and networking cards, and that's probably not as good as just running fibre or DAC direct attached cable for 10 gigabit networking. This is actually an entire other world, so I'll loop back to this in a separate video because otherwise I'd be talking for ages, but in hindsight I probably should have just run DAC cable down my walls and also purchase SFP plus switches and networking cards, but lesson learned. But at least I do now have a working 10 gigabit network, which I'll show off in a minute, and that's pretty cool. When it came to actually buying the 10 gigabit networking switch, I found the choice is a bit overwhelming, to be honest. That's because I was actually used to buying cheap unmanaged switches from companies like TP-Link and Netgear, which were under £20. They were super reliable, because none of these had died on me yet, and they have really amazing reviews across the board. A cheap gigabit switch from a reputable company is often rock solid, able to deliver its constant gigabit speeds 24/7 with no issues at all. But 10 gigabit switches aren't like this. So many of the reviews seemed good on the surface, but when you dug into them, a decently large number of customers actually had issues with dropping network speeds, needing to reset the switches every day, or simply they'd switch dying altogether after a matter of months. And some of these switch companies actually seem to have poor or non-existent support, which isn't really ideal. So I kind of started to conclude that there's no point of trading in a super reliable, highly rated 1 gigabit unmanaged switch for a less reliable and potentially buggy 2.5 or 10 gigabit switch. Yes, I might get faster throughput in some circumstances, especially when creating a brand new project and importing all of the 4K footage, but everything else might be laggier due to having more bugs and less reliability. To combat this, I end up paying a premium for a Ubiquiti switch, and I'll loop back to this point in just 1 second. But firstly, another issue that I actually faced, and it was quite a big one, is with my main PC, which is micro ATX. It's got micro ATX motherboard and case, and the double slot graphics card completely blocks the other PCI Express slot, meaning that I then couldn't actually fit my hot and noisy 10 gigabit networking card in, which was a pity. I tried loads of different things, including brute forcing in, which was a fairly stupid idea on my part, in hindsight, because it could have actually killed the PCI Express slots or even the card. But I also checked out riser cables, but these were then too bulky and rigid, and I couldn't really easily include them in my really small micro ATX case because my case has no real mounting points for them, so that sucked. Lesson learned. In the end, I gave up on installing this card in my workstation PC altogether. Instead, I'm just using my motherboard's 2.5 gig Ethernet port. I will look to upgrade my main computer to an ATX motherboard and case at some point, but right now I'm in this weird half state with a 10 gigabit switch and home lab NAS, but nothing to fully take advantage of this. So at this point, I should probably specifically talk about how I actually upgraded to 10 gigabit networking. And I guess I should say upgraded, not upgraded, because I do have a 10 gigabit network, albeit with only one device to fully take advantage of it. So as I touched on earlier, I knew that I wanted a solid and reliable network switch, which meant going for a company like Netgear, Cisco, or Ubiquiti. Those first two were quite expensive, but luckily Ubiquiti has a suitable switch that is often mentioned on all the relevant subreddits. Plus, it's fully managed, meaning I get a bunch of extra information, logging, and features to actually control my upgraded home network of two devices, but it's a future-proof investment, I guess. Yes, I chose the Ubiquiti Flex XG switch that admittedly only has 4 gigabit ports and only 1 gigabit of uplink, but that's good enough for me right now. Yes, it cost me £250, which is more than I originally hoped to pay, but I'm still more than happy. I have no issues with connection speeds randomly dropping down, and I like that I can access all the extra management features via browser or even my phone. It's really cool, actually. That's all great then, but was it actually worth upgrading? I joked in the intro that I saved myself 20 seconds each week when video editing, and that probably is all I've actually saved right now because I'm stuck to 2.5 gigabit networking. But naturally, upgrading to 10 gigabit networking is an investment so that I can support more devices in the future, streaming everything from my NAS, and also potentially having higher res or higher bitrate cameras and recordings in the future without suddenly being bottlenecked by a gigabit switch. So let's drill into some results. When I first start off a project, I'll have footage from two of my cameras plus separate audio. The cameras are currently set to record at 60 megabits per second. When I drag these files in, Premiere Pro will instantly start ingesting them and also creating peak files for them so you can see the audio waveforms and things like that. And if I just drag these three files in, I can see in Task Manager that my network speeds hit 1.2 gigabytes and then 1.5 gigabytes, but quickly they drop back down below sub gigabit speeds as you can see, and then it's finished, it's ingested. However, if I instead set my cameras to record at 100 megabits per second and I drag these video files into a new project, my network speeds then do peak higher, sort of. They quickly hit 1.8 gigabits per second, but then this also quickly falls back down to sub-gigabit speeds, averaging around 700 megabits. Now this is only when creating a new project, which I might only do once or twice a week, but I also have a bunch of extra footage, which is called B-roll, that will appear on the screen as I talk. If I have a screen recording of a game and I drag this onto my project, then it will peak higher because game recordings are often fairly high bitrate, and I see network speeds hitting around 2 gigabits per second based on multiple tests that I carried out. In this case it's 1.9, but I did see it hit 2 gigabits per second. Finally, let's say that I'm super organized and I already have most of my B-roll ready to go when I create a new project. This will potentially involve dozens of files, but mostly lower bitrate clips and static images. But when I highlight these and I drag these into a project, Premiere Pro thinks about it because it's quite a lot of files. But then over in Task Manager, we can see that it often is around 700 to 800 megabits per second, and it doesn't really go beyond that. But as I said, this is for fairly low bitrate clips and static images, things like that, so it won't stretch the network too much. But if I start a new project and I drag everything in, the camera files, the audio, and the B-roll, What we can see is that network usage does spike quite a lot, although it is often below 1 gigabit, probably for the B-roll. Every so often it gets the A-roll, the camera footage and things like that, and then it does go above gigabit to around 1.4 or even 1.8 gigabits per second on a few occasions, which is all pretty interesting, at least to me. Now you could use this data and say that you don't really need above gigabit networking based on the user results, but this is a one-off cost. So while I do only save 20 seconds or so a week right now, I have so much more potential in terms of future proofing. So was it worth it? No, but did I have fun? Let me think. Also no. But at least now I can introduce myself at parties by saying, "Hi, I'm Tristan and I have 10 gigabit networking via my Ubiquiti products," and that's made it all worth it. This video is actually part of a series I'm doing to upgrade my content creation workflow, moving everything from my workstation PC to my home lab NAS. You can check out the other videos in the series by clicking somewhere here, and I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please click the thumbs up button and please subscribe to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.